The Willandra Lakes region was World Heritage listed over 30 years ago. It's been declared as an important site because of its geological history and the Aboriginal history of Aboriginal people living and surviving in this land for over 40,000 years.
The Sustaining Willandra project is helping us better understand what the investments of the government, as well as commitments of the landholder, are having on the landscape, as well as the cultural values of the World Heritage Area. The Willandra Lakes is a significant landscape, and it's also a fragile landscape. And part of the job in managing that is, you know, we need to know that the decisions that we're making and what we're doing is actually working. We need to show that we're protecting and conserving the universal values of the Willandra Lakes, and we need to know that we can do that into the future by meeting the commitments of our plan and management.
It's important for everybody to look after country, so this is a shared responsibility. We all have a connection to country. We have a responsibility to look after country for generations to come. We need to leave it in a better condition than how we found it.
Well, it's a living landscape. There's at least 48,000 years and possibly beyond of Aboriginal people living in this landscape. You know, it supported us back then, it's still supporting people today. So, you know, it's rich in resources even today. So when Aboriginal people talk about country, we talk about it at a holistic view. We're a part of the country. You know, everything within our, what we call our Nurrumpa, is right down to the little ant, to the blade of grass, is everything that we care about. We don't just care about one thing, we care about everything.
This landscape is definitely important values to different people. For the Aboriginal people, for starters, it's important values because this is the place we belong to. It's where our ancestors, where we come from. For the pastoral, it's also important to them in different ways because it's their livelihood. And also for conservation values, for the vegetation and the animals, and to protect all that, you need to protect the environment for all them values, they all link together. And by pastoralists, Aboriginal people, government agencies and scientists working together, is the aim is to look after country, it looks after you.
Yeah, one of the main issues we got on country is protecting the integrity of our soaks beside these dunes. You know, these soaks have been here for thousands of years and maintained life for our people in this country in the hardest times. You know, now, since Europeans have been coming in, they're utilising these soaks as well for their sheep, so for watering. It's great to see that the landholders today have moved a lot of their water points out away from our soaks, so the vegetation's healthy around it. If we look after them and get them right, they'll be here for future generations, because if we lose them now, we're going to lose them forever.
We're running an organic dorper operation at the moment, and we're finding it's a lot more sustainable for this sort of country. We've found over the generations of what my grandfather and father have taught us, that if you really look after the country, then it really looks after you. The main issues for managing this sort of country is with pests. Rabbits are probably at the forefront. If we can get them under control, then we can really reduce soil erosion, wind erosion, and by doing that, then we're really looking after the cultural side and the pastoral side of this sort of country.
If we don't start addressing the rabbits now, they'll start impacting on our sites and causing soil erosion, and a lot of our sites are in pretty sensitive areas.
We've got native spinach and things growing here.
In 95, the first lot of individual property plans were developed for the properties in the World Heritage Area, which helped us protect the World Heritage values as well as help landholders manage their land.
Helping out with government assistance has really improved our way of farming because it's been able to us to make better informed decisions in ways of looking after the country and looking after the cultural areas as well.
What you're probably looking at too is the bottom of a hole.
Well, the Sustaining Willandra project has brought me back to this country that I used to work in decades ago. Thinking about it, there's been big improvements in the country. Where the stock used to overgraze and track across the dunes, the country's looking a lot better. The biggest threat to the culture and other values in this landscape is erosion, and principally wind erosion. And ground cover is the key to controlling that. The more ground cover you've got, in fact, if it's over 50%, you don't get wind erosion. Over the years, the landholders have noticed this improvement to country, and specifically at this site, around these soaks. But for the landholders and also for the World Heritage Unit, they haven't been able to prove it. Through this project, we now have the evidence that ground cover has improved as a result of moving these watering points. We've been able to use the satellite imagery, which we get every fortnight, to measure ground cover accurately at the paddock scale.
The fencing off of the dunes has made it easier for us to reduce the trafficking over the sand dunes, and therefore reducing the chance of wind erosion and soil erosion. By centralising the watering points, we've really been able to improve the total grazing pressure within the paddock as a whole, and by removing the corner ones, it takes the pressure off those sorts of areas.
Here in this ancient landscape, the science is really making a difference. It's reaffirmed to the landholders, they're doing the right thing by the country and the values of this landscape, but really importantly for the decision makers. You know, they can now know and be confident that they're doing the right thing by country.
This is the first time we've been able to show that we've reduced erosion in the World Heritage Area, and erosion is the number one threat to its values. We can now better justify the government investment thanks to spatial modelling, and have a better idea of where to invest in the future.
Well, we knew we were sort of on the right track. We were seeing big improvements in ground pasture and different plans coming back, and it was great to actually have some scientific backing to really show that it really was working.
With managing Mungo National Park, where a lot of decisions are made about the natural and cultural features and in protecting the environment. A science project like this, which gets a lot of information together, can really help us and can make us reassess decisions to say, yes, you're doing the right thing, or you need to rethink and readapt. With this national park and in the World Heritage Area, there's a really close working relationship with the Aboriginal community, so the three tribal groups, the Muddy Muddy, Barkindji and Niampa people. And in everything we do, it's about fulfilling those aspirations of engagement, of being on country, working on country, being on country and making decisions. You know, there's a lot of good things that come from that. And in this science project, it shows that people are connecting, are out on country, and with the science behind it, that the decision making are including Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal people and a whole wide range of input, and we see some really good results of that.
Bringing Aboriginal cultural values and scientific views walking side by side to manage country, the only way we can do this is by working together collaboratively. If we don't work together, one will be missing key knowledge from each other. For too long in the past, it's always been a scientific point of view. Aboriginal cultural values weren't even bought into it. We need to start marrying cultural knowledge with scientific knowledge, and that way we'll get a lot better understanding of what we're talking about.
We've got a lot of challenges coming our way around managing this landscape, and we've got a much better chance if we can bring the culture and the science into part of the solution. And by bringing science and culture together, we can bring a lot more people on the journey.